It's week 10 and I'm going to talk about scanning documents. So last week I talked about scanning images or photos, slides for use in the book. Now I'm going to talk about scanning documents. This is probably more of what ends up happening through the course of research. So up to this point, I've used a flatbed scanner for my previous book, and then I kind of started that way for this book. But why scan documents? So if you have them on hand, maybe it seems a little redundant because like, I already have this document, I own it. But the nice thing about scanning documents is this way you can access them anywhere and at any time, and once you have them on cloud storage. So I find that to be very useful, as well as you can share that document. So if you're communicating with somebody on a subject and you know they have a question or something like that, you can share that with them to maybe prompt an answer from them or maybe trigger their memory about a certain time or place. So having a scan is huge. Because the other thing too that we found is that as you research, when you first go into a subject, you think you go in with one intent and you're looking for particular subjects, topics within a document. And as time goes on, you may find that you've kind of shifted your priorities when it comes to what you're writing about or what you're researching, and then you need to go back because, you know, I never did search for topic, you know, G. I was looking only for topics A through E. So now you can go back because you have that document. Let me go check, and sure enough, there was something that was listed in there that's now relevant. So in my first book, we found that we did that actually probably more than we ever would have anticipated from the very get-go. So as a result of not being as diligent about capturing anything and everything at first, we had to go back and kind of revisit some of our original source material and scan things that we had not opted to scan the first time, even news articles, downloading them the first time. So kind of scanning everything you can get your hands on is probably worth it. It doesn't cost much. Storage is relatively free, and then you at least cover all your bases moving forward. So primarily, again, I've been using a flatbed scanner, so I'm a little slow in the uptake, as I soon or recently found out. So for example here, so I'm going to go ahead and scan this document, which is actually, it's a magazine that I bought on eBay over the last, say, year or two, and its cover story is the campus bus service at Kent State. So obviously I own it, so I could reference it whenever, but again, if it's digital, then it's easier for me to access it when I don't have this in front of me, because I'm not going to carry this around with me as I would a laptop. So I'm going to go ahead and scan that and then kind of show you what I do to put that all together. All right, so after turning on the scanner, I'm going to go ahead and scan the cover to start. Obviously, it's not really needed, doesn't provide any information, but I guess it'll be a nice cover to the document that I'm eventually going to make. Face down in the corner that has the little arrow up here saying where it's going to scan from. Once that's down, then just hit my magic scan button for documents. And then let it do its work. Now, one thing about scanning documents, unlike scanning images, that the DPI that I mentioned in images, or the dots per inch, aren't as needed here. We're not looking for print quality. We just need something that's readable. So you can drop the dots per inch down to 100, maybe even less than that. I just need to be able to read it. I don't need to be able to print it, or it's not going to show up in the final book. So that does save space. It makes the scans go a lot faster. So now I'm done with that, I'm going to go ahead and find the news article that I need in the document, or in this magazine now. So this particular document, actually, in addition to the article I'm looking for, has a guest editorial by Joe Fiala, or Joseph D. Fiala here, who was the general manager of the bus service at the time. So a little bonus article that I'm going to include in this document. So since it's scanning from this upper corner, I need to flip around and put it in upside down. I can fix that in post. and then put the top down and then scan again. And then find the actual article here. Here we go. Campus bus service, a unique transportation solution. It's a couple pages. It does have some photos, some of which I don't think I've actually seen any of these. So these are kind of unique. I'm assuming these aren't, I don't know, maybe they are their own from this publication. So if I wanted to include any of these in the book, I could scan this at a higher DPI. I don't know if that's a lot of focus. I could scan this at a higher DPI to possibly include them, but to be honest, I'm not running short of bus photos, so I'm going to go ahead and skip that. I'll scan it, but I'm not going to scan it as a anything more than just a document page. So I'm going to do this, scan these, and repeat as necessary. Now that the pages are all scanned out of that magazine, I'm going to go ahead and combine them into one document. So using Adobe Acrobat Pro, you can go to Tools, and there's a tool within that that says Combine Files. So you open that up, and then I'm going to take all of the documents, or the pages of the document I have, and I'm just going to drag them in. So there's the scans of all of them. And you can see some of them are upside down, because we had to scan them that way, just the way the orientation of the flatbed was. So what I'm going to do is actually I'm going to go ahead and just combine them all as it is, and I'll fix that. So hit combine. So here's the document, all combined, all the different pages that I have, including the front cover and the editorial, as well as the article. But some of the pages are upside down. So what you can do is use the tool Organize Pages, and then you can find the ones upside down and then just turn them right side up. Oops. Try that again. And last one, close. Now everything is right set up and readable. So once I'm happy with the organization of the file, I'm going to go ahead and save it. And again, my method of labeling these things, I start with the year. So 1986, it's the fifth month because it's the May issue. I don't know a date, so I put two X's for that. And then just say Bus Ride Magazine CBS article. And actually, you know what, I put WDS at the end. This is coming out of my collection since I own it. And then hit save. Easy enough. So handling the documents, it's kind of how we did it up to this point. And it's pretty labor intensive because you have to physically put the page down, flip it, and then there's some editing in post in a way. And that took a lot. We did a lot of scanning the first time. A lot of it was in special collections. You just go up and they would hand you a collection. You sit down the flatbed scanner just like this one and you would scan them that way. So my last visit to special collections at Kent State, which was my first visit for this particular book, they no longer have a scanner there. That was a bit shocking because we had used it so heavily in the first book. To lose that was huge. So they said that they would be willing to scan everything. That's kind of what libraries do. But the amount of material that we had gathered in the first one, and I'm assuming I'm going to have quite a bit on this one, what's the turnaround going to be? If I go into a box of documents and pull out, boy, there's 60 pages that I want. There's 100 pages that I want. What's it going to take them to scan that? Because you can see how long it took me to do a flatbed scanner of just one document. Multiply that times 30, 40, or 50 times, and the workload's going to be really high for them. And I'm sure they'll do it, but it might be like, we'll get it to you in a couple weeks. Like, well, what am I going to do in a couple weeks? I'm just waiting for my research to come in that I can start kind of pulling information out, organizing it, or even, you know, kind of maybe reading it in its full entirety. So that was a bit disappointing to see that change had happened within there. But something that, I don't know if someone told it to me or I don't know how I came across it, but can you do anything with a phone? And I'm not young, but I'm also not that old. So I looked into that. And sure enough, Adobe, which is a service that I use, obviously, for Photoshop and the scanning stuff, they have an app. And they're not unique in this. There's plenty of other apps. You do a search on the phone and or in the, you know, the store, and I found plenty of other scanning apps, which are basically that. You take a photo with your phone, and it'll turn it into a PDF file. So one of my other things that I want to scan is this huge stack of documents. So this is a photocopy of the internal newsletter, the employee newsletters for the campus bus service starting in 1968. So roughly a year and a half after they started. And this is all of their little internal document, which is just amazing. And just scanning through it, there's so much little great little nuggets about new buses or new routes or employees and training and all that stuff. So I have a paper copy, but again, I'd love to have this digital so that I can reference this whenever. If I'm not at my house, I'm out of town, that I can pull this off of my Google Drive and read it, or you know, at least reference it at that point. So this will be a much better experience than trying to flatbed scan all of this. This has got to be, I don't know, a couple hundred pages, and it would take hours upon hours. So just to kind of demonstrate what I've learned with my brief experience of using the phone for scanning and how much easier this is. So first thing I'll have to do is actually just open the app. I'm not really going to show it to you because, again, this isn't about an Adobe app. This is just about really any app that can scan these things. But what I found, which is so nice, it's smart enough that all you have to do is put it on a flat surface. It finds the document by itself. And then once you have it, it takes a picture. Put that one aside and then rinse and repeat. And this is each of these pages would take, I don't know how many seconds per, but you can just knock these out 5 to 10 seconds each. And then do this for the whole stack. So there is an option to use a flash, should the lighting you be in not be very good. So I'll try some with that. Again, I'm not looking for a perfect scan, I'm looking for a legible scan, just so something that I can read. So once I've taken photos of all of the images, it just says save to PDF, and then it goes ahead and actually then saves it to the cloud. Or their cloud service. And then inside of Adobe Acrobat, I can go to the document cloud, and here it is. And that took no time at all. And I'm not necessarily seeing any improvement, it's legible. So there's actually no improvement with using a flash, at least in the lighting that I have in my little room here. So that's, that was so quick. So I just did a little bit over a year's worth of documents in the course of just a few minutes, and it would have taken, probably tenfold to try to pull that off by scanning each one individually. So that's kind of what I've learned with scanning documents. Out with the old, in with the new. Flatbed scanners have their place when it comes to images. We want the highest quality possible so that it's suitable for reproducing in a book. But for documents, something that I just need to have a copy of that's legible that I can reference, smartphone. That's what I'm going to use from here on out. And then therefore too, now I'm hoping when I go to special collections that if I'm flipping through a box of documents and there's something that I want, it's just a matter of me putting on a flat surface, taking a photo of it with my phone, and then when I'm done, it's going to send it to the cloud in a PDF file. So then by the time I get home, I can just pull it off. I don't even have to bring a thumb drive in. That was something in the past too. Boy, you scan a lot of stuff, you have to make sure the thumb drive to take it all home. So scanning a document. So that's where I've been doing it for a while. I've only started using this in the last week, if that. So a lot of time was wasted up to this point, and could have really streamlined it. Well, it's going to get faster. Unfortunately, I don't have as much to scan on hand, and I'm waiting for special collections, which kind of takes me to, obviously, I'm aware of it, or most people are aware of it when this is being made, but as soon as time goes past, people will forget. But this is being the, what is today's date? The date that I'm actually shooting this on is March 22nd, 2020. And we're in the heart of the start of the coronavirus pandemic. So my last week, the Kent State University had shut down classes, limited access to libraries. Students were allowed to stay on campus, but there was just no classes. And that has now changed a week later, where the university has shut down all buildings. So obviously the priority is being safe and not getting any near anyone to limit its spread. But obviously for the purpose of a book, that that basically stops a lot of this. So I'm gonna keep plugging away with what I have. Again, this is kind of just my journal of the experience of writing this book. So I'm thinking that there may be weeks where I have nothing to say, and I may just be like, hey, future me, remember that this is week 12 and you can't do anything. So that's week 10. Also, all haircut places are shut down. So this will also be a journal of how my hair changes in the upcoming weeks, months. Who knows, right? That we're just at the beginning of all this. So that's it for week 10, scanning of documents. And well, next week's 11. So here we go. Bye now.